Why don't we get started, everybody? I'm Rob Atkinson, president of ICIF. I want to welcome you to this Monday afternoon event with my colleague Michael Lind, and to talk about Michael's relatively new book. I guess it came out in April, is that right? And for those of you who have not read it, I encourage you to do so. Land of Promise, an economic history of the United States. There's a wonderful quote by Joseph Schumpeter once. I think it was a quote by Schumpeter. Somebody asked him what was more important, econometrics or economic history. And he answered without batting an eye, he said, without a doubt, it's economic history. If you want to understand economics, understand economic history is a lot more important than econometrics, which is the exact opposite of today's view among most economists. Economic history is not even a required course in virtually all economic. Is that right, Justin? Did you take economic history?
I was in an oddball university where there was a historian who actually still had prowess. So,
all right,
but very rare.
Very rare that you actually study history. And another famous quote by Lewis Mumford is that if you want to understand where the future is going, you need a long on-ramp of history to understand where the future is going to go. So that's why I've been impressed with Michael Lind's work over the years and this new book, because he can talk about it, but really focuses on understanding the depth of how American economic history has really been the government and the market deeply, deeply intertwined throughout our history, and that going forward, the notion that somehow we can do it with only one side or the other pulling is really a misnomer. So, for those of you who don't know, Michael is the policy director at New America Foundation, their economic growth program. He also co-founded New America, must be over 12 years
15
ago?
Years.
15 years ago, with Ted Halstead and Cheryl Schwenninger. He also is the author or co-author of many, many books, The Radical Center, The Future of American Politics, Made in Texas, George W. Bush and the Southern Takeover of American Politics, a 2003 book, The American Way of Strategy, 2006, What Lincoln Believed, 2005. It also says in the thing a number of nonfiction books, and then I thought, well, why would they put nonfiction books in there? But I realize that Michael has also written several fiction books, including The Alamo and a children's book. I didn't realize. Is it worth getting for my six-year-old?
She's about the right age. I'll get you a free copy.
So I'm going to turn it over to Michael to talk about Land of Promise, and then I'll probably have a few questions and interactions, and then we can open it up for discussion.
Well, thanks, Rob. It's a particular pleasure to be here. These are our fellow travelers or co-religionists to some point. One of my inspirations in looking for models for this kind of history, there are very few models. One of them was Rob's a book in 2006, The Past and Future of America's Economy.
2003.
As well as some of the work of Carlotta Perez and other historians of the Schumpeterian school. It's not an academic argumentative treatise. It's a general narrative history just for people who want to find out what happened, but what keeps it from being a dry-as-dust chronicle of just one thing after another, and I don't know about you, but I always found American economic history incredibly tedious in grade school. You know, you start off with, there's the cotton gin invented by Eli Whitney, and then all of these people are piling into Conestoga wagons and going west, and the next thing you know, the stock market has crashed, and people are jumping out of windows, and, you know, and then they're standing in soup lines in the Depression, and then they're all rich in the 50s.
With a picture of a car.
Exactly. I thought there's got to be room for a narrative history of the American economy that tells a story. So it's not just one damn thing after the other. And the story it tells it develops a theme that's familiar in the literature of this, the School of Economics, started by Joseph Schumpeter and carried on by various people, which is that innovation is not continuous and incremental. Some innovations are more important than others. Some technologies are more important than others. These are called general purpose technologies or disruptive technologies, although academics being what they are, they quibble with these terms, that there have been a series of industrial revolutions within the larger arc of the single industrial transformation as humanity has moved from agrarian civilization to an industrial urban civilization based on artificial machinery substituting for animal and human muscle power, and with mineral energy sources replacing wind and water, and again, muscle power. So the number of these subsidiary industrial revolutions depends on the expert you read. Some say there are three, others there are four or five. I go in land of promise with three industrial revolutions since the first industrial revolution of the mid-18th century based on the steam engine. A second industrial revolution, second wave of innovation based on the internal combustion engine and electrical technology developed in the 1860s, which the historian of technology, Vaclav Smil, thinks was by far the most productive era, the 1860s, 1870s, dwarfing any period of innovation before or after. And finally, there's the information technology revolution, which has its origins in the very late 1930s and then gets a boost from the Pentagon during the World War II and the Cold War. And you have not only computer technology and the internet, notwithstanding Grover Gordon Krovitz's op-ed in the Wall Street Journal today saying that the internet was invited by the private sector. It was not. Satellites, technology, all of the technological underpinnings of today's globalized and IT-based economy. And if you take a kind of broad view of economic history, not only in the U.S., but in Britain, Western Europe, the world as a whole, then you can actually tell a story in which these basic general-purpose technologies, over time, it takes some time to, once they're invented, to figure out how to apply them in different areas where they transform the economy. But essentially, a fairly small number of basic technologies transform and recreate the economy and society again and again and again. So the steam engine, you have the steam engine, it's developed to pump water out of coal mines in Britain. The moment it's perfected, and there was a long process of incremental innovation there, but it really is perfected by James Watt in the 1770s. At that point, people start thinking, you put this on a wagon, then you have a steam wagon, which becomes the locomotive. You can put it on a ship, and then you have a steam ship. And so much of the economic history from the late 18th century to the mid-19th century is working out the application of steam power. And, of course, in a factory, you can use the steam engine to replace what had been the major source of energy for a lot of factories, which was water power and water mills. Just replace the mill with a steam engine and fired up with coal. So there you have essentially three very basic ideas, all using one invention, the steam engine, and absolutely transformative effects on the economy and society. And you can tell the same story with the internal combustion engine, with the transistor and the internet and modern information technology. So that's one of the themes from this Schumpeterian literature, which is in the background of my narrative history. Another, which again is not original with me by any means, is the idea that the technology-driven transformation of the economy results in a lag between the increasingly innovative economy and the society that's responding to it and the outmoded political and legal institutions. And that's true in all countries. True in 19th century Britain, it's true in Germany, it's true in Argentina, it's true in China, it's true everywhere. But I look at it particularly in the case of the United States, where a number of historians, including myself, have long argued that American political history, like American economic history, is not continuous and incremental, but there tend to be cataclysmic breaks, revolutions, if you want to call it that. The Civil War and Reconstruction were a de facto second American revolution. It wasn't simply a restoration of the status quo ante. It sort of created a new country in many ways. So did the New Deal. And World War II, which in some ways is more important than than the New Deal, and we can get into that in the discussion session if you want. So there have been, by this count, three American republics. One founded in after the Civil War. The first in the 1780s and 90s, the second in the 1860s and 70s, and the third in the 1930s and 40s. I think, at least I hope, we are living in the last days of the Third American Republic. I think the system now is so utterly out of sync with the evolution of the economy and the society that it's falling apart and it's going to be replaced by something else. It could be worse. I hope it is a Fourth American Republic. It could be the first American principate or the first consulate or something. But I think when we emerge from this real crisis, which began in 2007, 2008, I think we're in for a generational period of transformation. It's not simply a matter of recovery. But we're not going back. Whatever emerges at the end of this process is going to be as different from the United States of the 80s and 90s as that was from the United States of the 1910s and 20s. I mean, it's really about Reconstruction. It's not about recovery at this point. If you line up these industrial revolutions and these American republics, or so I argue a land of promise, you get this kind of interesting pattern in which for 20, 30, 40 years, the old American political order, which worked quite well for an earlier economy and society, just gets more and more out of sync with this evolving economy. And the pressures build up, but because in ordinary times, the vested interests can pretty effectively resist change, particularly under the US system, which is very fractionated in its distribution of power. It takes some kind of crisis, like the Civil War or the New Deal or the Great Depression, World War II, to finally break this logjam. And what you see, and again, this is different from what you're taught. What we're taught is that during the Civil War, the Lincoln Republicans decided to have a national banking system. You know, they decided to raise the tariff. They decided. Actually, all of those plans had been on the shelf for 20 or 30, 40 years. They already existed. It's just they were blocked. In this case, by the Southern planter class, whose senators in Congress, once they withdrew from Congress, they opened the way to do all of these things. But it's not that the Lincoln Republicans thought all this stuff up, you know, while they're firing on Fort Sumter. You know, it's just they had these existing plans. And if you look at almost every piece of New Deal legislation in the 30s, it had been around since the 1890s or the 1900s. You know, whether it was federal deposit insurance, that had been around as a proposal in Congress since the 1890s. These things had just been blocked. You could finally move on them because of this sense of urgency and crisis. So the country does respond, at least under the pressure of events, and finally does this delayed modernization of the political and legal system to fit the emerging economy. But what happens at that point is, at the very moment that the political order is now finally being brought up to date, you're having a completely new wave of invention and technological breakthrough in a bunch of laboratories over here nobody's paying any attention to. So the Lincoln administration presides over the completion of the locomotive-based transportation network with the Transcontinental Railroad. It represents the victory of the kind of steam-based, you know, factory-based industrial capitalism of the North. But at that very moment in the 1860s, as I noted, you're getting the invention of the automobile and of electrical power grids, things like that, which are going to completely overthrow this system which has just reached its maturity and which is now being reflected in law and public policy. By the same token, when what is still the New Deal regime, we're still living in sort of the last days, I think, of the New Deal regime. Its basic elements have been somewhat battered, but they're still there. When Roosevelt is putting all of this together in the 30s and 40s, and then his successors, including modern Republicans like Eisenhower and Richard Nixon, are assembling this Third Republic, they're essentially responding to, you know, the mature phase of the Second Industrial Revolution. So if you think about what were the great infrastructure projects of Franklin Roosevelt and Dwight Eisenhower, it was rural electrification, completing the national electric grid and regulating the electrical utilities under Roosevelt, and it was the interstate highway system under Eisenhower, which actually, as I point out, was a Roosevelt initiative, although Eisenhower rightly gets credit for getting this through Congress with his prestige. In other words, the interstate highway system, these two grids, the road grid and the electrical grid, were based on technologies which had actually been invented in the 1860s. But it actually takes until the 1930s and 40s and 50s for the mature technologies, you know, finally to get this final comprehensive bill up with the backing of the government. And even as the federal government is building out the mature technologies of the Second Industrial Revolution, largely in government-funded labs, you have the technologies of the Third Revolution, which are going to turn everything upside down, are being invented off stage, right? Computer technology, nuclear energy, satellite technology, even the container ship, which becomes very important and starts out from very small precedents, including a shipping in World War II, was one of the influences on it. So the good news is that there's always something for the next generation of Americans to do, because even if we finally catch up and fulfill this unfulfilled leftover agenda, then at that very moment, it's sort of like it's kind of a grotesque image, but it's like that creature in Alien, you know, that sort of gnawing people from you know, bursts out suddenly. That at the very moment you create a system that is up to date technologically, at that moment, there's the seed of technological innovation, which is going to completely shatter the system that you've created. And so essentially every generation or two, there's a task to be done in updating and modernizing the country's political system to reflect the changing economy. So, I'd rather have a conversation, you know, than just a lecture. So if you'd like, we can have a discussion.
So that's great, Michael. You're right about that. Some people have that there's been three, some have been four. In my book, I essentially argued there was a transformation in the 1840s and then in the 1890s and the 1940s. Now, so I have kind of four, you know, three, sort of irrelevant. The major point, I think, of this scholarship is that there are these structural transformations that occur and then these lag. And that's principally Carlotta Perez's work on this, who's a scholar at Sussex in the UK. But the question I have is, you know, in the past when we've had these big leaps forward with technology, we eventually catch up partly through these kind of, it's almost like tectonic plates where the pressures get so much and then you have an earthquake and change. But it seems to me now that our politics is really one party that wants to retain the Third Republic and the other party that wants to go back to the Second Republic. I don't see a lot of push for getting to the Fourth Republic.
Yeah, I think that's right. And I had expected the crisis of the Great Recession to have led to more change and rethinking by now. We're about 4 years into it. Nevertheless, I think if we wait long enough, it may just be too early. A lot of people assumed that when Obama's, particularly on the left, they assume Obama's elected, it's 1932, you know, Bush is Hoover, Obama's FDR. But what if Obama's actually Herbert Hoover, right? The first 4 years, what if 2008 was 1929, right? And so the first few years of the Depression under Hoover, everyone, including a lot of the progressives, thought this was a really, really bad recession, and at any moment there's going to be a recovery and it's being held back, but we're going to go back to the system the way it was. And that was the expectation of a lot of, you know, people like Franklin Roosevelt criticizing Hoover for, you know, all of this debt spending, right? And what finally the bottom came out, and there was the second recession that when credit Anstalt failed in Vienna. And the German banks, once again, the German banks were started in America, and then the second act started in Germany and Central Europe. And then the German and European economy collapsed. And at that point, it was clear that, you know, we're in real trouble. And that opened the way for much more radical thinking in 1932, which would not have been the case had Roosevelt run and been elected, say, in 1928, right? So if you think, as my colleagues and I are coming to think, that this is the beginning of a 15 or 20 years crisis, and we're only a little way into it, then in a sense it doesn't really matter who the next president is, in as much as if it's Romney, they're not going to repeal the New Deal and, you know, institute a libertarian utopia. And if it's Obama, no matter who it is, we're going to have to improvise and come up with new systems under the pressure of events. There is a room for those of us in the policy world and in journalism and in the academy to think this through before it happens. Because the danger is when you finally do get the logjam and there's this rush of reform, whoever has the policy papers there, you know, that can actually be enacted into law, is going to have a great advantage over people thinking, oh, well, you know, let's just sort of think about what this means. And you see this, I had some fun in the book tweaking the liberals in this case, in the case of federal deposit insurance, because we now see this as a great triumph of the New Deal. Actually, it was kind of a harebrained William Jennings Bryan populist scheme. The United States, unlike all the other industrial countries, had a system of unit banking in the 19th century where state laws, and bolstered by federal laws, prevented branch banking not only among states but within states between cities. And some of you may be as old as I am, and you can recall what an enormous hassle it was to try to get a check cashed in another city in your own state as recently as the 1970s, right? So as a result of all these little tiny protected unit banks, some of which were, you know, did wonderful things for the local people, but most of which were simply kind of money pools, you know, reptile funds for the local political boss. The U.S. had wave after wave of financial panics in the 19th century, early 20th century. All of these had stopped in Britain and Canada and Australia, where you had branch banking, because if a bank went out of business, got absorbed by a larger national bank, and then it bailed out the bank. So when the Glass-Steagall Financial Reform Act is being passed in the 1930s, Stigall is how he pronounced it, Henry Stigall from Alabama. He was a reactionary segregationist Jeffersonian. And like the other Jeffersonians, he wanted deposit insurance as an alternative to branch banking so that you could continue to have this protectionist local bank system, which was so important, particularly to the southern political class. Roosevelt hated it and wanted to veto the bill. Roosevelt was for unlimited branch banking and a few national banks. So when people now talk about Roosevelt's federal deposit insurance, he must be rolling over in his grave. This was something he just held his nose and they passed it. But that's an example of a reform that had just been floating around. In this case, a dubious idea in my opinion, because I think that had we gone the way of Canada, we would have had all these financial panics. You know, you'd have a few big banks, but they could have been much more strictly regulated instead of all these little tiny banks. Be that as it may, that's an example of a reform that's just sitting there. And my concern is the right has been very prolific and successful in funding all kinds of schemes, many of which I think are harebrained, some of which I think are smart, for redoing everything from, you know, Social Security to Medicare. It's mostly vouchers. You create vouchers for everything. But the point is, you know, there's just endless policy papers about how you dismantle Social Security, how you do this, how you do that. The reaction of the mainstream progressives has just been purely defensive. It's just been constantly fighting off the latest assault by the Chicago School libertarians. And so neither party, as you say, you know, really has a story in which they say, look, we can no more recreate the world of Franklin Roosevelt and Dwight Eisenhower than they could have created the Republic of Abraham Lincoln and any of us, etc. Right? What they were trying to do in their time was to use the tools of their era in order to preserve these basic American values of freedom and equality and democracy, but in a different way from the way it had been done historically. inevitably in a somewhat unprecedented way, although there would be parallels in other countries around, you know, the same level of technological development. So it seems to me that's what's missing from the debate, right? Saying that we can't go back to 1950. We certainly can't go back to 1900, which many of the more reactionary conservatives want. We have to go forward to 2030 and 2050, right? And so what would a society in which, and I'll give you an example. I promised a conversation, not a lecture, but I'll just end with this point. The mid-20th century American mechanism for having a strong middle class involved having raising the wages of the third or so of the workforce that was in manufacturing at the time. And, you know, through the spending of the well-paid UAW workers, this then helped out the people in the Detroit barber, you know, the Detroit realtor, all of these people. So it was sort of diffused through that sector. Now, I firmly believe we need to rebuild our share of manufacturing, both the national economy and the global economy. But because of productivity, in the very long run, a lot of this is going to be done by robots, right? You are going to have an economy in which, even if much of the value added is in this very highly automated traded sector, which includes mining and energy and agriculture, as well as advanced manufacturing, most people are going to be in the non-traded domestic service sector, right? So even if that manufacturing worker, George Jetson, you know, who's the one employee of the industrial company,
Spacely
Sprockets, and I'm showing my age again, he just presses one button and that's all he does all day. Even if he is a millionaire, there's no way he can spend enough money to compensate for the loss of all these lunch bucket carrying, you know, Detroit manufacturing workers in the further around the country. And so what do you do to raise the incomes of the nurses and nursing aides and elder care workers and all of the rest? I mean, I don't know the answer. I think I know the kinds of options. But that's something that the mid-20th century liberals and conservatives, they didn't have to think about it. I mean, this was a sort of, what was science fiction for them is coming true for us, right? When it comes to the world economy, they envisioned a world, the whole point of post-war economic strategy was a world in which they assumed countries would trade finished products across borders, right? So everything would be made here, and then you would sell a finished product, and another country would trade you a finished product. Global supply chains were not physically possible in the modern sense before you had computers and satellites with container ships backing all of this stuff up. So what would, you know, the Council of Economic Advisors and Keynes and you know, these other people at Bretton Woods have, what sort of system would they have designed in the 1940s if they had envisioned this science fiction world with global supply chains in which, you know, this microphone might have pieces from different continents? It didn't occur to them that you would have countries struggling to monopolize industry. This just was not a possibility given the technology of the 1950s. It is a possibility now. For example, if you look at something I follow, which is a global commercial shipbuilding, the state-backed South Korean industry, under government orders from the military dictatorship, went from zero to now about 50% of global shipbuilding capacity. Again, under orders from the government, China has gone from about zero commercial shipbuilding capacity to about 30% of the global whole, and may surpass the South Koreans. Both of them surpass the Japanese, right? In these modern industries with increasing returns to scale, which means that the more you make, the cheaper they are, and the more efficient your factories are, and then that allows you to have lower prices and kind of a virtuous circle, and bigger markets. It's perfectly possible for one country to dominate, you know, manufacturing one industry after another, or in all industries. What you see is aerospace is dominated by two countries. It's the United States. It's Boeing and Airbus, basically. Glass is dominated by a couple of companies. And this is not necessarily a bad thing, but my point is, no one had ever thought about this. because you had production took place within national borders, and trade was in the finished products, right? And you had this theory of comparative advantage about why countries would specialize, right? So you know, that's my basic takeaway point, that is, we are living in the science fiction future of the people who designed our contemporary institutions. And even if you think, as I do, that the last wave of reform in the New Deal in the middle of the 20th century was by and large an appropriate response to the challenges of the time, if you could bring back Roosevelt today, you know, after he got lectured for smoking in public, you know, he would tell you, don't copy us, right? You have to do something different. You can't just, you know, we would have, in these circumstances, we would have done something quite different.
Well, that was the whole Roosevelt.
Ceaseless experimentation.
Exactly, ceaseless experimentation. Yeah. So let me ask you one question before we open it up. By the way, having grown up in the U.S. with a father who was a Canadian banker, I heard pretty much every single night at dinner how the American banking system was an abysmal failure and why the Americans should move to branch banking, which I agree with him. I think he was right, as you said. Given that so we're moving into this new world and it's going to be continuingly different, and it's a different world than how the republic was set up or the governance structure, it seems to me we should be articulating a set of principles if there were a political constituency for the Fourth Republic. What are those principles? And let me suggest a couple and get your reaction. It seems to me one of those principles has got to be essentially a system that respects customization. Mm-hmm. That really the system we've been under is a system of basically mass production, and so all the defenders of the school system, you're either between individual libertarianism of Horace Mann to just keep it the way it is and just give it a little bit more money, as opposed to thinking about a school system that is really fundamentally respects individual differentiation and a prison system and a health system and all of these systems. Seems to me that kind of has to be principle number one. Principle number two seems to me has to be something about global governance, however you want to describe that, that the idea that we can govern a complex global economy with so many interlinkages around agriculture, energy, environment, and supply chains with it, the current system seems to be a misnomer, that you really can't do that. Now, what that looks like, and that there needs to be something about a new kind of ubiquitous digital infrastructure, and then some recognition of perhaps kind of that the core competitive advantage and source of advantage we have and need is going to be around knowledge and creativity and those kinds of skills. But there may be others, and again, taking those and then putting them into actual things. But I mean, do you agree with that assessment, Michael? Do you see that in the book? Or?
Well, what I try to do in the book, among other things, is to, at every stage, to integrate the story of America's economic responses to these challenges with world politics, because there's a tendency just to treat American economic history in this silo, and it's just going away from the 1800s to the 2000s, and then you have these little things like the world wars, right? I'll start with the global governance, because it all depends on what the world looks like. You know, if we go into a period of great power conflict again, like the Cold War, you know, which is conceivable, presumably with China, maybe somebody else, not a hot war, but a cold war, then all bets are off, right? I mean, if you return to cold war type politics, you're going to have trade embargoes, you're going to have espionage, industrial espionage, even more than you have now. You know, you're going to have limits on immigration and limits on investment. So that's the first thing you have to decide, right? That is, there are things possible in a world with peace among the great powers, which are just out of question. If you have a world of great power rivalry that's really serious, it's not just competition for, you know, making iPhones, but, you know, life and death struggles, then that solves a lot of the disputes about trade organization. That is, the great powers are going to sponsor their own militarily relevant industries, and they don't care what the economics PhDs say, right? I mean, they're going to fund and make sure they control whatever is relevant. You know, in terms of military manufacturing. Well, that's the thing. Because you could argue there have been three or four you know, there is a literature written largely by political scientists of comparative capitalism called The Varieties of Capitalism Literature. I'd recommend it to everybody. It should be particularly to PhD neoclassical economists, because the point is that modern German, Japanese, and Chinese capitalism is not liberal capitalism in the Dutch Anglo-American sense, where essentially the government is an umpire, you set basic rules, and then, you know, who cares, potato chips, microchips that, even in Germany, which has been democratic, we're talking about West Germany, the Federal Republic of Germany, a lot of the systems for making it an export machine are built on Third Reich and Weimar Republic precedents that never went away. So, you know, what they do is, instead of cranking out Panzers, you crank out, you know, BMWs or whatever, but the labor relations, you know, the apprenticeship, a lot of that stuff has very deep roots in Germany's 19th and 20th century attempt to catch up with Britain and compete with the United States. So Germany itself is still, there's, you know, like the residual DNA is this kind of state capitalism. Germany, one of Germany's bigger banks is the Kreditanstalt für Wiedervereinigung, if you can say that three times, KfW. It actually shows you the how flexible these different national traditions are. After World War II, a lot of new dealers went to Germany from in the U.S. occupation authorities, and they said, "Oh, you know, the Marshall Plan. We're going to give you all this money. We're not going to be like World War I and punish you. So some new Hitler comes to power." And takes vengeance, we're going to rebuild you and integrate you into the liberal democratic alliance. And so the Germans said, well, we have no way of dispensing all of this money from the Marshall Plan. And so the American advisors said, oh, well, we have this thing called the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, which was created by Herbert Hoover and then greatly expanded as the state capitalist element of the New Deal. So the Germans said, oh, well, we'll do that here. And so they created the KfW. And then once they had dispensed with all of the Marshall Fund aid, they said, well, this is such a useful organization. Let's just keep doing it to help out German manufacturers and so on. So it plays a key role in subsidizing Germany's export-oriented Mittelstand, their middle-sized family-owned businesses to this day. In 1953, the Republican Party in the United States abolishes the Reconstruction Finance Corporation. A sinister socialist institution.
Maybe what we should do is just look at all of the great institutions we set up in other countries and bring them back to the U.S. And one of the points we make in our forthcoming book is if you look at the Taiwanese big national technology program, it was set up by the AID, Agency for International Development, back in the 1970s. And then the major Korean quality and innovation agencies were also set up by AID. There's a wonderful white paper, you know, this old Xerox thing that somebody put into a PDF you can get on the AID website, which has a wonderful case study of how they set this whole thing up in Korea so that they could improve quality and improve technological innovation in Korean industry, all because we were fighting against the Red Menace, and there was no possible way the Koreans could ever compete with us.
Well, we did land reform in the Philippines and in Japan. The American occupation authorities, you could never do this in the U.S., right? But they say, well, one reason you don't have a democracy is because you have this oligarchy and too many families control too much of the land, so we're going to break up the estates and give it to small farmers who are the basis of the Japanese and South Korean, you know, and I mean the Philippine, you know, system to this day. So that's just my one warning. It all depends on whether you have a peaceful world or a world where these disguised trade rivalries turn into actual shooting wars, probably proxies. And I just think there's something that we have to, I have one foot in the military, strategic world. My background is in foreign policy and one foot in economic policy. And these are usually discussed in isolation, but I try to bring them together in the book. The point about choice and customization, I think that's right. Increasingly, what you're going to see is, for example, with biotech, if they can tell me that because of my family history, you know, I have a chance to have a brain tumor when I'm 72 that's, you know, like 38%, then your conventional models of private insurance no longer work, right? Because you can try to, you know, do things like the Affordable Care Act, where you're trying to prop up an industry, which in my opinion is doomed by technology, with private health insurance. But you're no longer in a case where there's no way to tell whether you or I will need this particular treatment, so we pool the risk. So they can predict exactly who's likely to get the particular treatment. And then it simply becomes a political decision. Are we going to help out the people likely to get brain tumors or not? Instead of forcing everyone else to subsidize them by creating this make-believe that there's this risk that's shared by everybody, right? You're going to get customization in obviously manufacturing with rapid prototyping and things like that. And I think that excites me much more than things like social media or that kind of thing. I mean, I think if you can get hobbyists in their garages with little, you know, rapid prototyping 3D printers, and they're actually making real physical things, right? You know, to me, you know, that's kind of a return to the old Yankee ingenuity. As opposed to gossiping about people on the internet or whatever social media does. But this may be my bias.
I'm going to tweet that idea.
But here's the thing about choice. I think that we were sold a bill of goods under the name of choice in the 90s and the 2000s by the financial industry, because they used this language, which I fell for a decade ago. My colleague Ted Hulston and I used some of this in our earlier work, and I now feel quite bitter about it, saying, oh, well, you know, everybody needs more choice, and so you should manage your investments more, right? You know, and so we'll have all these proliferating 401k products and all of this stuff. Well, after two stock market crashes within a decade, the idea that choice requires all Americans to pretend that ordinary people are going to be day traders and competing with these guys in Wall Street, you know, I think that was a fraud on the public. And if anything, you need simple, non-gameable, basic economic security systems, including Social Security. If you could phase out a lot of 401ks and increase the Social Security payout, you'd have to come up with money. That's a much less risky retirement option than saying we're going to keep coming up with all of these elaborately gamed things. So I'm in favor of customization, but I'm skeptical about choice, where the choice is, you know, my bank sending me this 40-page thing with fine print.
Yeah.
And then the economist saying, well, transparency, you know, Michael Lind will read all 40 pages and then consult with the other 500,000 shareholders of the bank. So we can't have regulation. Transparency will police, you know, these institutions. That's just my one warning about choice. On the final thought, digital infrastructure. There's been this tendency in the last couple of years to say, oh, where's the next new big thing, right? You know, we've done IT, we've done the digital economy, let's go on biotech, nanotech, photonics, you know, something totally new. I think that's a misreading of history. I'd be interested to know whether you agree. I think we're still in the early mature phase of IT, in the sense that we're kind of now with IT where... you know, let's say automobile technology was around World War I, where you already had some automobiles, you had some planes, but the great age of the family automobile and of the jetliner was in the 1950s and 1960s. What we're seeing with things like rapid prototyping, which is essentially IT enabled manufacturing, with a lot of the biotech stuff, like having sensors in people. You know,
genomic sequencing.
It's IT. I mean, these are applications of IT, and let's just so these are derivatives of the original IT revolution, and that's ongoing. So now, if you take this seriously, then you have to say all of this whining about startups, saying, oh, we need there aren't as many startups as there were in the early IT years, and we now need to. Move on to the next big thing, and let's put all of our money in nanotech startups or something like that. That's a complete misreading of the way technologies evolve, because what you see, for example, in IT, you get this long period of government-backed incubation where essentially the first adopters and those investors were the Pentagon and a few big companies like IBM and Xerox and so on. it's only when the technology is becoming mature that it starts getting spun out into commercialization by Bill Gates and Steve Jobs. And that's when you get the great golden age of startups in Silicon Valley, venture capital. But inevitably, most baby dinosaurs do not grow up. They get eaten, and then there are a few big dinosaurs, the successful ones, which is where we are now in a lot of these areas, Microsoft, Google, you know, Intel, a few others. And you know, I remember meeting the Inktomi guy. Do you remember Inktomi and Dogpile? And, you know, it's a Darwinian process. So you would expect that as an industry develops, the glory days of the startups within that industry would be gone, and you would have a few large corporations, which they could become predatory monopolies, but as Schumpeter argued, a lot of big corporations can be very creative innovators to the extent that they actually have rents, monopoly rents, if they plow these back into internal research. You know, basic research like Bell Labs in the middle of the 20th century.
Yeah, so let me go to just a quick point on that. I think, Michael, part of the reason why people, I think, are confused or troubled or about why don't we have more entrepreneurship is they assume that economics is a linear process, that one year is pretty much the same as the next year, just it might be a little bit bigger and a little bit richer. And if instead you believe that it's this cyclical process where there's these or the S curves. Entrepreneurship occurs early in the S curve. That's when there's new opportunity. Everybody floods to the opportunity because they're all experimenting, and then the dinosaurs get eaten, and then you get more maturity, and then eventually a new technology system emerges. What's interesting is we had an event a couple of years ago with Bob Axalt, who's at George Mason. I think he's at George Mason. He's actually one of the leading people in the world on computational social science, he uses advanced agent-based modeling to do social science research. And in fact, he actually has a model of the U.S. economy with 170 million agents, and he programs the agents with these very, and it's actually a much more robust model than the econometric linear programming models that they have at Treasury. But anyway, he's modeled innovation. And what he found is that when you model innovation with agents, that what you get is clumps. You get exactly what Schumpeter modeled in theory, and from looking at history, you get the same thing. And so I think that's a better way, as you point out in the book, that we will get innovation, we will get entrepreneurship when we get the next wave of innovation that's emergent. So why don't we open it up if you want to add something or question or contradict, you can identify yourself, please.
Will Amatruda. One comment and one question. You said that if there's a new Cold War, all bets are off, and you cited the hypothesis that immigration would be restricted. And yet my memory is that it was precisely during the Cold War that immigration laws were liberalized in 1965, and we got rid of the national origins quotas.
That's correct. My point wasn't about immigration. It was about trade, free flows of trade and investment and so on. Now, it is true that during the Cold War, the U.S. liberalized immigration from other countries, partly out of humanitarian motives, partly as a propaganda thing, saying, see, all these people want to flee from behind the Iron Curtain and come to us. And the U.S. Pressured the Soviets with the Jackson-Vanik Amendment over allowing Soviet Jews to leave in the 1970s and 80s to make them look bad, right? At the same time, if you look at World War II or even the Cold War, the aftermath, skilled individuals become pawns in great power politics. And so we got our Germans, Kraft Ehrich and Wernher von Braun and so on, and the Russians got their Germans, right? And they went to work for the governments on the rival sides, right? So I think even in the immigration area, if you had serious great power conflict, you're not going to get a free market in labor. You know, all this is going to be distorted by power politics.
Did you have a follow up?
My other question was, you talked about how as the economy changes and there's a lag in the political and legal institutions. Sometime in the 50s, the think tank in Santa Barbara, the Center for the Study of Democratic Institutions, got together to write a new proposed U.S. Constitution.
Was that Hutchinson's?
Yeah, that was Hutchings and Gunnar Myrdal and others. Were they on to something? In the course of writing your book, did you look at their proposed constitution, and would it have been an advance?
I didn't. In my former life as an editor at Harper's and the New Republic and so on, I used to get proposed new constitutions in the mail all the time, mostly from retired men in my native Texas. And they all basically had the same provisions. They said they're very technocratic people coming up with new constitutions. And Ross Perot was kind of like this. There shall be a council of smart people. They shall be selected by all of the people with the highest IQs, right? So I just wanted to send a piece back saying, I assume you think you're going to be one of the 100 in the council. The Constitution does change when we have these de facto revolutions, like the Civil War and Reconstruction and the New Deal. Now, with the Civil War and Reconstruction, it was actually amended, the 13th, 14th, 15th Amendments. I mean, they just changed it, created national citizenship, abolished slavery, and so on. With the New Deal, as Bruce Ackerman at Yale Law School argues, it was changed by means of interpretation of the Constitution. That is, suddenly the court decided that a lot of this New Deal legislation that it had been striking down as unconstitutional was in fact constitutional. So it's kind of an informal amendment of the Constitution. I suspect, given the difficulty of amending the Constitution formally, that if you get a fourth republic and a fifth and a sixth at some point, it will follow the New Deal model rather than the Reconstruction model. In other words, the government will just do stuff, and the Supreme Court will say, okay, you know,
we'll call it
the Constitution. They'll call it a tax, right? Whatever, you know. So I think now, you know, other countries are more honest about their revolutions. The French are now in their fifth republic, right, since 1789. You know, arguably we've had almost as many republics as they do, but we pretend that we've had this uninterrupted, you know, reign of the federal constitution since it was adopted 1787 and 88. The French are more honest about it. Periodically, they just come up with a new republic, write a new constitution. There's the story I like to tell about this American tourist in Paris, and he goes to this Parisian bookseller and asks for a copy of the latest French constitution. And the bookseller, with great disdain, says, "We do not deal in periodical literature."
One riff on that: during the Fourth Republic, when governments were changing all the time, there was a paint company which actually had the advertising slogan, "Republics pass, sedate paint lasts."
I'm going to go in order. So right here, and then here. Yeah.
So you talked about the connection between the technological change.
Could you identify yourself? Sorry.
Oh, sorry. Krister Watson at the National Science Foundation. So you talked about the technological changes previous to the revolution, the New Deal, and how that affected things like rural electrification and then the interstate highway system. But what I did not see a connection between was those technological changes and changes in like the labor system in the U.S.
Right.
Could you draw a connection or talk about that a bit?
Yes, and better yet, it's in my book. Here's the link. It's not that somebody invents a new gadget, and then people say, oh my God, you know, our system is obsolete, we need new things. There's a difference between invention, which is the new gadget, and then there's innovation, which is finding out ways to use this gadget to increase productivity in agriculture and in mining and in retail and in distribution. So, for example, when Lincoln and his fellow Republicans create the Second Republic, as far as I can tell, I'm having written a book about Lincoln, he assumed that, in spite of steam technology, that most businesses would be small, owner-operated businesses forever, right? It really was not until the 1880s and 1890s that you had large corporations. From about the 1850s to the 1880s, the railroads were the one giant corporation with professional management and all of this stuff, raising the money from the stock market. It's only in the 1890s that you get this wave of consolidations that produces these giant trusts, in corporations, 80s and 90s. So the vision of Henry Clay and of Lincoln of this new industrial system was much of the population would remain rural. There would be these, small factories dotting the landscape, and there would be railroads, connecting everybody. So, but what happens is, instead of that, by 1900, you have U.S. Steel, and you have Standard Oil, and you have these giant corporations with professional managers hiring goons to beat up, the immigrant workers who were brought in to do unskilled labor because the skilled labor jobs have been eliminated by advanced technology, like Bessemer steel furnaces. And this was not what the people who had built the system after the Civil War had expected or anticipated. And it's interesting that the Republican Party was the dominant party at this time, and you get a divide within the Republicans. You get the old school Republicans, the so-called stalwarts. They said, if it's good enough for Abe Lincoln, it's good enough for us in 1910, right? So we're for the tariff and against unions. And then you had people like Theodore Roosevelt and the progressives, who mostly came out of the Republican Party in the North. And they said, look, this is not what they pictured. And even if it was, who cares? I mean, we're in a new world now. So it's not that the technology itself causes a change directly. It's that through entrepreneurs, when it as well as the government, in the case of the infrastructure build-outs, it creates new markets. It changes labor systems. People are shed from agriculture to industry, and then they're shed from industry to the service sector, and all of this creates new challenges for the government. So it's mediated by these intermediary factors.
I don't know, I differ slightly with that interpretation, Michael, because I think the technology in and of itself, and Chandler, I think, talks about this, in and of itself led to an ability to have economies of scale that work.
Well, it enables it.
It enables.
But someone, J.P. Morgan, has to actually put
sure, someone puts
together.
It together.
That's my point,
yeah.
That's all.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Exactly. And then now those economies of scale have here, and then here, and then I'm going to go on and try to order the order. Yeah.
Okay. Eric Miller, represent Canada's Department of Industry in Washington. So one of the tasks that my senior officials have given me over the summer is to do some thinking about Americans and the view of government.
About American what?
About Americans and the view of government. And so one in particularly has this changed over the course of the crisis. And so with listening to you talk, I'm wondering, as you get into the waning days of these periods, you get an intensification of skepticism about government. And then, I guess, as a corollary, have Americans' view of the role of government changed since the crisis of 2007-2008 began?
Good question. I argue in Land of Promise that you get kind of cycles, Hamiltonian and Jeffersonian. Hamilton, after Alexander Hamilton, the first Treasury Secretary, who sponsored a government-backed program of industrial and infrastructure modernization, that was later carried on by Henry Clay of Kentucky, the great Kentucky senator, and Clay's disciple, Abraham Lincoln, who when asked to describe himself, he'd always say, I'm an old school Henry Clay Whig. That's how he was quite blatant about it. And arguably, FDR and the modern Republicans are in that Hamiltonian nation-building tradition as well. And when you have this crisis, what happens is it just becomes clear to everyone that the government, particularly the national government, just has to act, right? And just has to take whatever measures are necessary, to deal with a crisis, build this new system. And so for about a generation, the federal government has this prestige, from successfully winning literally war. It was a civil war in the case of the second American Revolution. It was World War II in the case of the third. And this prestige then wears off after about 20 or 30 years, and you get this Jeffersonian backlash after Thomas Jefferson, the first Secretary of State and the third President of the United States. In the Jeffersonian tradition, it's not laissez-faire. Jeffersonians are not libertarians. In fact, libertarianism in the modern sense is alien to all American traditions. It's a European import. I could go into detail. But the Jeffersonians are producerists. they want the government to intervene to protect small producers against big producers. So they're not just worried about big government, they're worried about big banks and big retail. So for example, the unit banking we were talking about earlier, that was a Jeffersonian measure. Massive intervention by the government to cripple large banks and of the Canadian type and protect small local banks. So the Jeffersonians have nothing against government when it's protecting the small businessman, you know, the small retailer, the small grocer, you know, whatever. Whereas the Hamiltonians have no problem with government as long as it's promoting overall national modernization and efficiency. They don't care if the small grocer goes out of business, that's not their problem. But it's not government versus market, but each has a different conception of how government should intervene in the markets. So the Jeffersonians, they tend to just be against big things in general, big government, big labor, whatever. And there's Jeffersonians on the left, the center, as well as the right. I argue in the book that starting with Jimmy Carter, who you may recall ran as the conservative, rural, Jeffersonian, virtuous yeoman from Plains, Georgia, who was going to clean up this corrupt, you know, country left by Richard Nixon and LBJ and all these big city people. So the modern Jeffersonian era actually begins with Carter and then deepens under Reagan, who says government is the problem, not the solution. And essentially the Democrats who have succeeded since Reagan, like Clinton and Obama, have internalized a lot of this quasi-Jeffersonian rhetoric, you know, just defensively in many cases. So I just think we're sort of at the end of that period because, you know, you could make a case in the 60s and 70s that government had overreached in Indochina. You know, a lot of its social reform projects were kind of ill-conceived and hasty. You know, that it was spending too much and it wasn't worried enough about the supply side of the economy. Make that case. You know, after a generation of deregulation and tax cuts, I just don't see how you can argue that more deregulation and more tax cuts, you know, are going to do the job. But the right has been very successful in channeling Jeffersonian producerist suspicion of bigness, which is by no means a monopoly of the right. I mean, William Jennings Bryan did it in the agrarian populace in the 19th century. But that's kind of the core of their political appeal. And it's so successful that essentially it's a kind of a bipartisan shtick now, you know. So the conservatives run against big government, the liberals run against big oil, and the conservatives, much to my amusement, the anti-environmentalists, now they're talking about big green, right? Now the truth is, liberal environmentalists do not like small oil either. Right, they're denouncing big oil. They just hate the oil and gas industry. Let's be honest. They hate small wildcatters as much as they hate Exxon. Right? You know, when the conservatives denounce big green organizations like the Sierra Club, they don't really like mom and pop environmentalists either. Right? But it's just we're now at this kind of reductio ad absurdum in American history, where slapping the adjective big in front of everything just, you know, appeals to this Jeffersonian reflex. But I just think it's tired. I mean, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe we'll have generations more of this. But I think at some point...
That's how we think about the think tank industry. We don't like big think tank. Like AEI and Brookings. We're in the
or New America. Don't mention that.
No, are you big or small? I can't tell. You're middle.
We're mid-size.
You're middle stock. Merrill and then here.
Merrill Buesner, I wanted to ask a question about this year's politics in the context of this discussion. Sort of like your framing of the Third Republic, one party, and the Second Republic being the other party. But I think the more immediate question, there is an immediate question that seems plays into what the future is going to be. What is the policy response to lay the groundwork for the future? What's out there now? I mean, when I think about historically, there were lots of programs put in place at state levels, experiments, right, things that were, and that happened at both levels, that seems to be lacking today. And so just one question to throw out there.
Yeah, it is
just right. George Jetson's Sprocket Company.
Yeah.
The fate of manufacturing in a fourth republic. What should be the government response? What should be the government role? Is the creation of
higher incomes, more wealth, you know, broadly shared with the general public, dependent on encouraging and doing something for certain sectors of the economy, specifically manufacturing? Or is it more laying more generalist, or what I got from you, Rob, was more a generalist kinds of principles, and then just let the chips fall where they're, microchips or potato chips fall where they're met?
Well, two cuts to answering that question. The first is, as we already discussed, you get one party that just says you don't need any policy. The market will do it, right? It just free the market will solve all the problems. You can subsidize the market through vouchers, but other than that, you just don't do anything. So that's one side. So you don't get any policy proposals from them. It's Mr. Market. Then the other side is far too much of it is defending the crumbling relics of the New Deal system of 50 years ago, right? So this causes a problem for me as a champion of manufacturing. I think that we need to rebuild our manufacturing base. However, I don't think most of it is going to be necessarily in older Midwestern and Northeastern industrial regions, right? Some of it can be. Most of those factory worker jobs, the good unionized, you know, 1950s type lunch bucket jobs, they really are doomed, not because manufacturing is doomed, but because you're going to get a lot of greenfield manufacturing with rapid prototyping and 20-somethings, you know, doing software, and it's just not going to resemble that kind of old, you know, Detroit lunch bucket type thing, right? And so to me, that's what we should be talking about, but we're not. Now, do I have my own opinions about this? Well, yes, and, you know, I can share them with you just briefly. You know, I think we have to answer a couple of questions. First, is the United States going to have an economic policy, an industrial policy, if you want to call it that, or not? That's the first basic decision. Do we say we simply set rules, and then if it turns out the United States is totally deindustrialized, in part by the action of state capitalist countries abroad, and then we simply, you know, become a nation of service workers or commodity exporters, that the market has spoken and we go along with that? I reject that. Partly because there is no global market. I mean, if the other three major economies, apart from the United States, are state capitalist China, state capitalist Japan, and in its own way, state capitalist Germany, which has rigged the currency of the euro and other things to promote its export industries, we don't have we have globalization, but it's not free market globalization. It's mercantilist globalization, right? And so to say that we're going to pretend this is not happening, that to pretend this is a free market, is to say that we will allow the policymakers of Beijing, Tokyo, Seoul, you know, Berlin, to determine what Americans will do. They will determine, these foreign governments will determine the composition of the United States economy, right? And so I reject that. So if you say, okay, but if you're going to have this economic strategy, you know, how do you want to do it so it doesn't simply become an incumbent protection ring, right? And so, you know, I think that's a real danger, particularly in the United States, because there's no quote from Oliver Wendell Holmes Jr., we're governed not by logic but by Congress. And so I think when people point to the authoritarian state capitalists as kind of a model for the U.S., whether it was Japan in the 70s, you know, or China now, like Thomas Friedman, why can't we be like China and build all of these, you know, high-speed railroads by fiat? Well, there's a downside to that system. I mean, they overbuild, they crash, massive corruption, you suppress the wages. We don't want that. It does seem to me we've been successful throughout our history, and Fred Block writes about this, you know, in having a kind of American decentralized kind of industrial policy. It's very regionalized. It was pioneered, the first American industrial policy was in agriculture, which was the biggest American industry in the 19th century. George Washington wanted an agricultural university. Finally, the Lincoln administration creates the Department of Agriculture. And what they do in the late 19th century is they set up federal scientific stations.
150th anniversary this month.
Well, let's celebrate.
Of the Morrell Act. July 62.
Right. The land grant colleges, it's the federal labs. And the United States has the most productive advanced scientific agriculture in the world. If you want to look at, we've never done this with manufacturing, and for the historical reason, it's just an accident of U.S. history. Because American manufacturing was so totally dominated by these large trusts and corporations by the early 1900s, and precisely because so many of them were these creative Schumpeterian innovators, you know, like AT&T and like Standard Oil and others, they never saw a need for this kind of government support of innovation and R&D and development the way the much more fragmented American farming system did, right? So, you know, periodically, there's a fascinating debate during and after World War II, which pitted a Vannevar Bush, who's one of the major figures in my book, the head of the Office of Strategic Research and Development during World War II, and, you know, the sort of father of modern government funding of R&D. And he wanted the government to give grants to big universities, Stanford and MIT, you know, and this kind of became our model. And it's very successful, you know, and he influenced the design of the National Science Foundation. There was a West Virginia congressman named Harley Kilgore, and Mari Maverick of Texas, another congressman, and they argued for a different system in which you would have decentralized federal labs which would work with small and medium-sized businesses the way that had been done with the agricultural extension system, you know, for 50 years. And they lost the argument. And so essentially, research was, you know, like big government grants to big research universities plus internal research of these corporations before a lot of them, you know, were destroyed by offshoring or global competition, or they spun off their R&D operations the way GE did, right, with to Lucent, I think, right?
Yeah.
So, and again, if you look at modern Germany, they have something called the Fraunhofer Institute, which is essentially the way that Kilgore and Maverick envisioned the National Science Foundation being. Basically, if you had a small business and your machine kept breaking and you didn't know why, you could take that in, you know, to the Mid-Atlantic area lab, and they would look at it and they would tell you how to fix it, and then, you know, they would set you up.
It's interesting, Mike, if you look at the two big dominant competitors, at least until China, it was Japan and Germany. They both put in place systems in the late 40s, early 50s to do exactly this. And we had this debate, and we didn't do it. So the Germans put in place Fraunhofer, the Japanese put in place what are called Kosushi centers, 65 prefecture centers. If you got a machine that doesn't work, you go 6 miles down the road and there it is. It's interesting that we didn't go down that path.
Yeah, and it's revived now and then, and it's always denounced as interfering with the market, even though we've always done this in agriculture. So, but as I said, if it's not that the German model, we don't want to repeat the German model, I mean, in its present form, which is based on a rigged currency and not having wages keep up with economic growth, various other things. But there's some elements of it, which, as I said, if the RFC had survived, if it had not been abolished, the Reconstruction Finance Corporation in 1953, we would have our version of Germany's KfW system. If we had gone this way with Kilgore and Maverick instead of Bush, then we would have all of these government labs doing research for small and medium businesses.
Let me just ask one quick follow-up. So implicit in your answer is that we do need an industrial policy. And it strikes me, and what I'm then hearing you say, I think, this is that our future prosperity in a new era, information technology and all of that, requires holding on somehow to George Jetson's Sprocket Company, right? That there's a connection between the two, and yet, you know, lots of people write and say there is no, you know, the number of people who are employed in manufacturing, you're never going to see the jobs there. So what explicitly is the connection between holding on to manufacturing and having
connection is, you know, 30 seconds because I want to make sure everybody else gets it.
Okay. Yeah, no, the connection is the multiplier effect, and it's also the difference between final demand services and business inputs. And just in 30 seconds, and there's a report we've done called Value Added about Advanced Manufacturing. You find it at the New America Foundation website. And we have the data from various scholars. I mean, we're compiling this. In OECD countries, roughly half of the so-called service economy consists of inputs to other businesses, which ultimately can go back to the productive economy, which the federal government defines as mining, manufacturing, agriculture, which includes energy and agriculture, right? Only about half of so-called service jobs are final demand services, like, you know, a massage therapist, all right? And so when, well, excuse me for quoting someone, Larry Summers says, well, you know, it talks about a service economy. He is not distinguishing between the insurers, you know, the R&D people, the people who are technically in services, you know, the bankers who are working for the agro metals industrial complex, and the massage therapist who's giving you a massage. They're all just service jobs, right? And that's just dumb. It's just
the other stupid answer to that, Merrill, is on September 27th, we're releasing a report that will explain all of that.
It will all be explained.
It will all be explained and revealed to you. We have these tablets that will be coming down from high on September 27th.
What date?
It's a tentative date of September 27th.
Thank goodness.
It's like all these millennial cults that, you know,
exactly,
keep pushing.
Well, after that, the world will end.
I'm Kathleen Fischer. I work for the American Partner Organization, the Alexander von Humboldt Foundation, German Foundation. I'd like to return to the global context for a moment, if I may. Because it seems to me that the kinds of tension you're describing between an outmoded political regulatory system and the economy are not unique to the United States, but you're observing it, including in Germany, although they have some things that work well, like Fraunhofer, they have others where the strains are showing, as well as across Europe. What's uniquely American about our struggle at this point? Do you see examples in other countries that are where they're dealing better with this, to, you know, finding a solution to overcoming this tension? Can we learn some lessons from them? Or what keeps you up at night if you think about the peculiar American case at this juncture?
Well, as a historian, having studied wars and horrors and mass migrations and the downfall of civilization, I sleep very well at night. So very little keeps me up. But I actually am very pessimistic about the next 10 or 20 years. I think this is the beginning. This is the end of the beginning of the crisis, to quote Churchill. It's not the beginning of the end. I think we're in the early stages of a prolonged crisis that's going to change the world, and not just the United States. If you look at, this is really the third Great Depression since the Industrial Era began. You had the Great Depression of the 30s, and then you had what they call the Long Depression, where you break it up into smaller depressions in the 1870s, 1880s. You didn't have depressions before you had mass production, because you had famines, but you didn't have this mismatch between inventory and sales. People didn't, you know, make 5,000 horseshoes and then there's no market for it. But this happens once you have mass production industries. What you'd see from the previous two is that you get a zero-sum politics both within the nation and between among nations. So in the 1870s and 1880s, this is the rise of anti-Semitism, of radical nationalism. In foreign affairs, it's the rise of protectionism and colonialism, and this carving up of Africa into nationally controlled markets and all of that. We all remember what happened everywhere, you know, outside of a few countries like the U.S. and France and Britain and the Scandinavian countries that remained democratic in the 1930s. You know, and so the politics, I think, in the United States and in Western Europe and the rest of the world, it's just following this zero-sum thing, right? Where, you know, suddenly realize that much of the wealth that we thought we had as a society was purely fictitious. It just never really existed, right? It was all notional, as they say, in the financial world. So the question is, who's going to take the loss, right? And then nations fragment internally. You know, and each faction wants to shove the cost of adjustment onto somebody else. So the banks want the taxpayers to swallow the loss, right? The homeowners want non-homeowners to swallow the loss. And it's all about everyone in the middle class wants the poor to take the big blow, right? First thing we do, we cut Medicaid and throw poor people out in the street, right? If we have to have balance the budget. So you just get this very nasty Hobbesian, Darwinian struggle within countries and among countries. And that's one reason why I don't rule out a spiral of international conflict, because that has tended to happen. Because, and particularly the protectionism, see, there's a difference between what you might call benign protectionism, which is simply promoting your infant industries until they're strong enough, and then you can, you know, liberalize your policy, which is kind of what the U.S. did in the 19th century. But the zero-sum trade wars in these post-depression eras, that's simply, it actually does make sense. It does make sense economically. I'm not an economist, but even Paul Krugman, even Paul Samuelson before he died, if you have a demand collapse, you know, of employment, import substitution will, you know, put people to work if you say, you know, Europeans can't buy non-European radios. They have to buy European radio. Well, you put European radio workers to work. I mean, it may be inefficient, but it does work, right, in terms of employment. So we saw this brief moment in 2009 where the G20 coordinated things, and you had this simultaneous stimulus. Since then, basically the Europeans and the East Asians have been simply piling on, making what they were already making the imbalances worse. So the Chinese stimulus largely went, as I understand it, to more export-oriented industry when there's no market for it.
And ours went to imports.
Ours went to imports, right? So ours is leaking out, helping them. You know, the Europeans are pursuing. You may disagree, but I think it's a suicidal policy of austerity. You know, the one thing you don't want to do when you have a quasi-depression caused by a collapse of demand is to contract demand even further by jacking up taxes and cutting spending, right? It's just then you get into this kind of death spiral. So that's not to say that I'm not just endorsing like simple Keynesianism where you just, you know, have stimulus spending as the solution to everything. As I say, I think you have to reconstruct the whole system. Ideally, the major industrial countries would come together, say, look, we're not going to have a trade war, but on the other hand, we're all of us want to have an aerospace industry, regardless of whether David Ricardo says we can or not. We're just going to. I mean, we're going to have a Brazilian aerospace industry, an Indian, a German, a Japanese, an American, Chinese, right? So let's just work out a system that's as friendly to the market as possible, where this is possible. We're just as an alternative to trade war. I think the problems of political collective action are so acute that I expect just beggar thy neighbor rivalries for years to come. That's my somewhat, it doesn't keep me awake at night since I have strong nerves, but that's my pessimistic prediction.
I think we have time for maybe one or two more. We'll go here and then here and then maybe keep them short, Michael. And yes, sir.
Thanks, Mr. Ack. Appreciate it. Mr. Lind, I feel like I'm sort of at a 12-step meeting. My name is Steve and I'm an IR fiend. I wanted to get to some of the pieces that you mentioned a bit ago, sort of take it to geosynchronous orbit. You pretty much outline the consequences. I guess I just want to plug in the actors. Is it pretty much fair to say that the international state system now, to keep with IR, is pretty much defined by us, not really teetering, but meandering economy, if that's even being generous. Germany, 40 or 60% of its exports are within Europe. And speaking of beggar thy neighbor, you know, the lender of last resort in greatest coercion, and the PRC. I mean, does it essentially boil down to those three, however dire the consequences are and the details of it would be?
Well, at this point, in the long run, I think that South Asia will be another center of the world economy, but India is still very poor compared to these other three. So, I think that's right. You have this German center of Europe, you have East Asia, where China now, you know, is becoming more and more dominant, and you have North America. If you look at
China, more dominant, even with a slowing economy.
Yeah, but that's the trend in the long run. There's just no rival in the region, even if they slow down, as I think they certainly will. So those are the building blocks. Now, the way they were arrayed from the period of the end of the Cold War to the present, it's what I call the Pax Americana system, which violates all of the ordinary international relations theory, which treats states as being homogeneous and they're all pursuing the same things. In fact, it was a hierarchical system in which the United States is the hegemonic power, unilaterally supplied security to the other industrial nations, including its former military enemies, Germany, Japan, and also China, which was our enemy for most of the Cold War. And in return, we said we would look the other way if, as long as they specialized in civilian production. So, you know, they could target our industries. The American industrialists would object. By the time it got up to the White House, the Pentagon and the State Department would say, oh, you know, we really need their, you know, we don't want to push this. And so we lose a few industries, you know, we preserve our hegemonic system. It was not simply the provision of unilateral military security. It was also the provision of the dollar as the world's reserve currency, and also the function of the American consumer as the world's consumer, in many cases, a first resort. You know, when you have countries like China that aren't making goods for their own people, but they're sending them to us. So the U.S. is just tapped out, right? It cannot fulfill, we can still fulfill the function of the world's reserve currency because the dollar is a safe haven, you know, for all the nervous people in the world. By default, we can carry out this military hegemony just because nobody else is challenging it at the moment. But the world economy can't be driven by the American consumer, and the most likely result is that you're going to get a regionalization of the world economy and a rebalancing either voluntarily, because the Europeans and the Chinese adopt a demand-led system of growth instead of export-oriented, or involuntarily because of it just breaks up in trade war.
That's right. So I have two more, just quick.
You can have one.
Okay.
I want to finish.
The triple wisdom.
The what?
The fiscal cliff.
Yeah, I think
I don't know if
we should kick the can down the road. I mean, it's crazy to me that here we are, we're still in this, what is a effective depression. I mean, we may be crawling out of it slowly. And we're going to suddenly withdraw demand from the economy.
So maybe next year will be 1937.
No, it could be, like the Roosevelt recession, when they thought, oh, the worst is over, and then now we can raise taxes and cut spending and plunged us back into mass unemployment, right? But the thing that just seems crazy to me is if you're a enlightened person in Washington or New York, you're more worried about the Social Security running out of money in 2037 or Medicare being too big in the year 2050 than you are about mass unemployment of idle people and idle corporate cash in 2012, 2013, 2014. It's this weird kind of, what's the opposite of myopia? I think it's hyperopia or something. It's farsightedness. You can't see what's in front of you, but the stuff way over there is precise. And, you know, partly I think it's simply because of an intellectual block. That is, ideology says we can't do anything now, so at least we should fix Social Security's problems, you know, 25 years from now. But I'm telling you, after the election, there's going to be this big push of moderate Democrats and Republicans to solve the problems of Social Security in the 2030s and 2040s and 2050s. Right? You heard it here.
Last comment.
James Tsang, your book is about economic history, and you've talked about the history, and you pointed out that its last century and a half has been very dynamic, and sounds like we've never been in equilibrium. What does your book say about the state of modern economics?
Nothing. I mean, it's sort of implied. I'm not an academic economist myself. I'm a historian and a journalist. You know, but I do think that much modern economics, you know, you've got a PhD, right? You know, if you make two changes in it, from two of the greatest economists of the 20th century, Schumpeter, and also Keynes, you know, who's great in his own way. If you make these two changes, then the Econ 101 that we're all taught, you throw out the window, right? The Keynesian one is the simpler one, which is simply that it's assumed that savings translates instantaneously into investment, right? But so Keynes points out, well, no, not necessarily. People can hoard their money. And you can be stuck at perpetually a lower level of economic functioning than you would be if that money were actually invested somewhere, right? So that's the basic Keynes twist. The basic Schumpeter twist is the assumption of all economics, including the Keynesian, the MIT Keynesians, is that equilibrium is the norm, you know, hysteresis, there is, it wobbles a bit, but then there's this equilibrium. And what I get from Schumpeter is, what if there's never any equilibrium whatsoever in any market or any industry, right? So what if the market never clears, right? So that the at the moment the typewriter market is starting to form an equilibrium, at that point the PC comes along. And then just when the PC, you have like this functioning competitive market, you know, we'll leave aside the oligopoly and monopoly, but let's say suddenly this, you know, like the neural implants in your brain replace the PC. So if you throw that out.
At today's point, the tablet.
The tablet, right. So, and it just seems to me that that pretty much is the story of the economy, you know, from James Watt in 1776 with the steam engine onwards. And I just don't see this equilibrium ever existing. It's just a constant. So the way I describe it, you know, instead of having this sort of pond where, you know, there's a disturbance and then there's a ripples and then it calms down again, and that's the normal condition of equilibrium. Did any of you see that movie, Who Killed Roger Rabbit, with the cartoons? It's like Toontown, right? I mean, that's actually the real world of the economy, you know, where at any moment, you know, someone will drop in, you know, a piano on your head, and then somebody will bounce and jump up to a 10th-story window, and it's just this bizarre, surreal, constantly shifting landscape. And all of these equations for modeling equilibrium, which were based on 19th-century physics of gases, I mean, that's interesting. I mean, it describes gases, and it describes ponds, maybe, after ripples, but it doesn't actually, you know, it's not a good map if you're in Toontown.
Okay. So with that, let me make two final closing comments. One is, for those of you who cannot get enough of this economics theory part, if you want to go to innovationeconomics.org, there's a little link there that says take the test. You can take a very brief test, and it will tell you whether you're a Keynesian, a Schumpeterian, or a neoclassicalist. You don't have to be an economist. You don't have to know anything about economics. You just have to have opinions.
What about an Austrian? What about the Austrians? We hear so much from them.
Well, we have we actually have conservative neoclassicalists,
okay,
and liberal neoclassicalists. So you get a picture of Art Laffer if you're a conservative, and Bob Rubin if you're a... I probably should update it, put Larry Summers' picture up instead. That would be more appropriate.
Well, I say that because on the economic history list at Amazon, for about a week, I actually defeated Friedrich von Hayek's road to serfdom. I've fallen back down, and Hayek is back.
Defeated his what?
Road to Serfdom by Friedrich von Hayek.
That's depressing that people are actually buying the book still.
Great numbers, evidently.
That was one I read in graduate school with Schumpeter. Anyway, the second thing I'd just say is we now have a long tradition of two book events in a row that are incredibly depressing. The last one was Ed Luce, Time to Start Thinking, as someone called his book, Time to Start Drinking, the decline of the U.S. economy, and now Michael's book, although Michael's book is, I think, only really depressing if you have the short run view.
Yeah, I think if you plan to live to the second half of the 21st century, then it's kind of optimistic. Yeah.
So buy the book for your children. Anyway.
Maybe grandchildren.
Yeah, maybe grandchildren. So with that, I do encourage you to buy the book. It's a great book. And as you can tell just from Michael's comments, you know, just gem after gem of insights in the book. So please join me in thanking Michael Lane.